continuing on with our 21 in 21 series here for Moto America, since the beginning of the Superbike class in 1976, we have had 21 champions. And since it's 2021, we thought we'd catch up with as many champs as we can. Please welcome number 9 on the list, Thomas Stevens. Hey, Thomas, how are you?
Hey, good morning, Greg. I'm doing good. How about yourself?
Yeah, doing really well. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it. And you're the 1991 champ, as memory serves. Is that right?
Yes, I am.
So tell me about racing in 1991, because as we chronicle these years with these champs that we talked to, the evolution of the Superbike, things get more sophisticated. But I think back in 1991, you guys were still in the experimental phase with playing with a ton of stuff to get a Superbike to work. Is that correct?
Yeah, correct. In 1990, real quick, when I got the call from Kenny to go test, the Superbike at Daytona for Yamaha, and I went down there and tested and came within a half a second of breaking his record. So I got the deal. So Yamaha was coming back into Superbike racing, and Terry was going to be Terry Vance was going to be the owner, and that's how I got the call. And then we went ahead and but the early years was, yes, because all the information as far as how to make the bike better had to come from the rider's input. So as opposed to like it is now, and I was lucky enough to transition in my career from not having data acquisition to having data acquisition. So it was, I can understand how easy it is today for the riders as far as to be able to get the bike straightened out, because the mechanics, the engineers can look at the computers and do all that. We didn't have that coming in. So a lot of it was with the rider input to make the bike better.
Now you're a Florida guy, as memory serves, right? So how did you get involved in motorcycle racing? Were you a flat tracker, a motocross kid? Did you road race? Like, how did you get involved?
Okay, well, I was originally, I'm from Maryland, and I lived in Maryland until I was 17. And once I graduated from high school, we moved to Florida. Growing up, dirt bikes, my uncle brought a mini bike home, and that was like the end of it. At 7, started riding, and my father had some friends of ours that raced. And I was 11, and he said, what do you think about going racing? And I was like, yeah, right, of course. So we spent the next, 6 years going racing. I won the Maryland State Youth Championship. Meanwhile, though, all this was happening. My dad had cancer from the time I was 6 years old until I was 16. So my dad passed away when I was 16. He wasn't around to see me win the championship. No, he was still around, but he couldn't go to the races anymore. So after I got done doing that, I raced one more year in 125s in Maryland. My mom was, said, what do you think about moving to Florida? I thought my racing was over. So we moved to Florida. I was working, partying, because every weekend for me prior was going to the races. I was riding home one day, and, I was a 19-year-old kid. And I was like, if I didn't go racing, I'd be 30 years old looking back going, I shoulda, coulda, woulda. Mm-hmm. I just was lucky enough to have some really good people around me that helped me financially, of course, like my mom, because I didn't have any money. I started out, the best way I knew how to go racing was to start sweeping floors at the motorcycle shop so I could get a discount, save my lunch money during the week so I could have another entry at the races. So, I was, I wanted to give it, and that's kind of how we got into it.
So then where did you start road racing then?
My road racing started at West Palm Beach. I went over and did the new rider school on my street bike because that's what I had for transportation. A friend of mine that I met was a pro. He said, no, I'll wire your bike up. Come on over. And then, of course, once I got on the racetrack, I was, once I got a street bike, I was really hooked from the speed. And then once you get on a racetrack, proper racetrack, and you can go as fast as you want to go, then you're really hooked. So I started at West Palm Beach, and things kind of I had another friend of mine that had a van that could take me to the races because he needed someone to go with, and he had money to put in the gas tank, which I didn't have, and we went racing, and it just kind of took off from there. I went from amateur to expert in 1 year because I won so many races in West Palm that they automatically bumped you up to expert. So then I applied for expert license with WIRA, and that first year, that was my first year of road racing from amateur to expert. I finished 5th in the country and the Yamaha F, you know, they were paying money at the time for the Grand National Final for the 600 class. And I finished fifth, and of course I was hooked and we were rolling.
And so from that time in your life until the time that you win the Superbike title, how many years in between that?
Well, let's see, it was 85 and I won the championship in, you know, 91. So by the time I first went road racing, it took me about 5 years. And then, but within 2 years, I won my first national. So, I mean, I was pretty, I'm no Eddie Lawson by any means, but I definitely had my head down. And in my day, I was, you know, I put it together. And within two years, I won my first national at Road Atlanta as an amateur expert. And basically, well, I finished second at Daytona, and then we went to Road Atlanta. I won that one. And like everyone was coming down going, like, who is this kid? Where did he come from? Like, Oodle Geedle came up to me, gave me his business card. Sammy Tanner from Arai back then gave me his business card and like, hey, call me. Cause you know, I was like, okay. Yeah. So things.
And you didn't have to sweep some floors.
Yeah, there you go. And then I started to where I was still going back to work, you know, at the end, winning nationals, being in magazines. I wasn't sweeping floors. I was the assistant service manager at that point. Mm. And my boss was lucky enough to give me time off to go to the races. So, and then it kind of took off from there. In 87, I was, started riding with John Ulrich, won the Weir Endurance Championship. I tested the Yoshimura bikes for Superbike, and the president of Yoshimura at the time said that he didn't think I had what it took, and that even though I came within a half a second riding Scott Gray's bike out of Willow, the guy said that, you know, he told John Ulrich that I didn't have what it took, and I was on the couch. I was going to ride for John again. The phone rang. It was Jim Allen from Dunlop. I was a Metzler guy at the time. And he said, hey, Kenny's looking to come back into the series. You should give him a call. And of course, as a kid, now Kenny Roberts was my, like I went to the dirt track races with my dad as a fan. And of course, Kenny was a superstar back then. So just a mere fact to get the call. And so I called him up and got me on the plane the next day. I went up to Modesto from LA to Modesto. Had a meeting with Kenny, and he said, I was on the way back. I said, Mr. Roberts, do I have the deal? And he said, if you call me Mr. Roberts, he said, if you effing call me Mr. Roberts again, I'll kick you out of the car. My name is Kenny. And I was Kenny. Yes, sir. Okay, Kenny, and dropped me off. And then I rode. So real quick, 88, 89, you know, I finished second at John in my first year on the 250s. And then 89 was a little rocky. I started falling down. Yamaha came back into the thing and went to Daytona and tested, and I got the deal. And you know, I finished fourth in 1990 as the rookie and won the Rookie of the Year, AMA Superbike Rookie of the Year. And then we came back with consistency. I had a new mechanic, Jim Leonard, and we won the championship.
Jim Leonard, a legend. But so, pick a story of the 1991 season. Is there a race or a moment in that season that really stands out for you?
Well, we knew, of course there is, and there's more than one, but the biggest one was winning the race at Mid-Ohio, because I was leading the championship going into Ohio. You know, Russell and Duhamel were, you know, starting to build some momentum, I guess you could say. So I was keeping an eye on those guys, and I knew that, you know, I qualified on the front row, and as the race progressed, I just went faster and faster and won the race and separated myself in points a little bit. And then the last, and I guess the biggest memory, of course, is, you know, we had to go run a street circuit in Miami, and it was unbelievably dangerous. And I knew I had to finish behind Scott no matter what. And that's what I did, because, you know, retain the champ or to become the champion. So my best memory is, man, coming around the last turn, knowing that I'd won the championship, my whole crew was up on, you know, and they were just going bonkers, because Yamaha had never won a Superbike championship till I did it. And that's like the greatest memory, of course. And then, you know, hoisting you over their heads and carrying you around. And, you know, I mean, it was a big deal, especially for a kid, you know, sweeping floors at the motorcycle shop to ascend to making a six-figure salary riding a motorcycle. It's a dream.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can only imagine. But so then after the championship, where did motorcycle racing take you, and when did you retire?
I raced up until 1998. I finished second in the Superbike Series. When I switched to Kawasaki, because I couldn't get a deal done with Terry, switched over to Kawasaki, finished second in the country. And I just didn't feel it. Kawasaki, Suzuki was coming back in, and I jumped onto that Some people would say money wagon, because they were offering me more money than I'd ever imagined that I was going to make. So I did that. And then by 1998, I was riding for Terry, and I had fallen, broken my collarbone. I had some really smart people around me. And Terry at one point said, you should think about retiring. And I was like, what? You know, retire? What? But then, you know, like after you've had multiple separate, I've broken clavicle 6 times. I was lucky. I never spent a night in the hospital. I lost 3 teammates along the way. Russ Paul, Donald Jacks. Went blank on who my other teammate was. But that being said, after I Larry Schwartzbach, you know, he was my teammate. He got killed at Mid-Ohio, but I had already left the team. But still, after all those years, you know, and being beat up, I was like, it's time for me to go. And that's what I did. And when I did retire, since I was only 34, I still had a deal with Chuck Graves to go to race the not the premier class, but he wasn't willing to come up with the money that I wanted to race. And if it wasn't 6 figures for me to get on the motorcycle, I wasn't willing to do it. And I retired. And then I did nothing for a few years, played a lot of golf, rode some motocross, helped my wife with her business. And then I got it. And then I got into the pool industry through a friend of mine. Now I'm a certified pool contractor. And I built that business. And while that business was building, I went ahead, Chuck Axelin and the Crave Group bought the series here in America. I reached out to Chuck, not in the position of like, give me a job, what can you do? I came to Moto America and said, Chuck, you know, if you need my help, you know, I'm here. And he said, well, I appreciate it. You know, I said, I'm not looking, I'm here to give back. And he went ahead and they called me about midway through the year and said, hey, would you be interested in being the rider representative? And I was like, sure. Hold on. Let me talk to my wife, make sure it's okay with her. Go back to the races. Absolutely. And that's what we did for the next, I did it for 4 years as the rider representative. And then I became, took on the position as race director because Doug Chandler was stepping down. I did that for about a year. And then it just got to a point for me with the COVID and everything that was going on. It was just, my business is an essential business and being on planes and and I had done it for 5 years and I just wasn't having any fun at it anymore. There's a lot of pressure that comes along with being the race director. And it was pressure that I handled for a year. And then the second year, I just had so much stuff going on that it was time for me to step down. And I, you know, told Chuck and the crew that, I have to step down. It's time for me to go. But it was a wonderful experience being back at the races for 5 years and being on the other side and working with guys like yourself and everyone else involved. Cause you know, Moto America's got a really great crew and they're doing a great job as far as the series.
What about motorcycling? Do you get to ride a motorcycle, whether it's on the street or the dirt or anything else now, you know, that you're into this after racing life that you have?
Well, yes, of course. Cause I have 2 sons, so we really didn't go very far as away. So yes, I have 2021 YZ250 that Yamaha provided me, which is great. I have a enduro bike that I'm not going to say which manufacturer it was, but it's a 21. I have a street bike. I still ride. And I watched Eddie's interview, which was great because I'm 56. You know, and the thing about motorcycling, it's something that you know, it's a sport that you can do for your whole life. So it's not, you know, it's kind of like a golf thing where you can play as a youth and you can play as an adult. So I'm still playing as an adult at 56 years old, go ride motocross woods. I rode actually yesterday at my sister's house with my kids. So I still enjoy it.
That's awesome. Well, Thomas, thanks so much for joining us here on our 21 and 21 series. It's great to get to know your story and to find out what life has in store for you right now. So thanks so much. Appreciate it.
You got it, Greg. Have a good rest of the day.
You too.